Welcome to Chicagonista Live, and this month we are coming to you live from the National Restaurant Association show here at Chicago's McCormick Place. We've got the gang back together from last month. Our friend Duong, Sheahan is traveling. We'll talk more about that shortly, but we're thrilled to have Miss Lori here filling in. MJ Tam, our founder, of course, of Chicagonista, and Beth Rosen, our resident troublemaker. Here to make more trouble. But we're thrilled you're with us, and as always, please tweet along with us, yes. Hashtag Chicagonista Live, as well as NRA Show. Tag the Restaurant Association Show and see all of the hot things that are happening. You guys have been traveling the floor, and I can't wait to hear all about it. And you guys visited a lot of great booths and rounded up some awesome certificates, I hear.
We have so much stuff to talk about. I mean, there's great stuff. We have food travelers taking around globally. We went through like 3 different countries in like, you know, the whole 4 days. Can you believe it? This is our 4th day here.
Well, they've been rounding up goodies to give away to you.
Yes.
So as you watch, tweet along. You may win a fabulous certificate to some wonderful dinner here in Chicago or perhaps in your city. We are going to talk about all kinds of things today. Among them, the donut crawl we went on. I skipped my workout last week.
How did I miss that? How was I not invited to the donut crawl?
We literally crawled after a full day of eating donuts.
We did crawl. And we're going to share Duong's pictures from Vietnam. It's an incredible story. Our girlfriend Duong, who we met through social media, she was among the refugees who fled Saigon in 1975 during the fall of Saigon. She has returned to Ho Chi Minh for the first time in 35 years. So we're gonna share her pictures. They're incredible, and we can't wait for you to see them. As always, we talk social media. These girls are always on top of what's hot in technology and what's on the internet. We're gonna talk about that. What else we got?
Well, I found some really fun stuff. You're going to want to stay tuned to see what I found at the National Restaurant Association show. We're going to play a little game with some of the items I found.
Before we go forward, we just want a quick mention about the tornado Oklahoma. And, you know, our prayers are with you guys. I know there's a lot going on outside there, and I'm sure you want to turn on to that. But just know that we're not forgetting you guys.
Absolutely not.
As we do the show.
And on Twitter, you know, follow the American Red Cross. They are so active in social media and in such an easy way to donate and help the people of Oklahoma. So definitely on our minds today, and tweet along about that as you watch us here on Chicagonista Live. But we're thrilled you're with us, and we welcome you to Chicagonista Live. We talk about social media, but we also talk about what's hot here in Chicago, because we are Chicagonista Live. And because we're here at McCormick Place, I usually work in the news business here in Chicago. This place has been in the news because it's being talked about for a major renovation, expansion, and that this is also being rumored as a place for a casino. a casino is coming to Chicago. There are various spots being mentioned around town, but McCormick Place has been a mainstay for conventions like the Restaurant Association. Do you guys feel that it needs expanding, renovating, updating? What do you think?
I think this neighborhood needs a lot. Yeah. You know, it revamped over the years, has turned into better. Of course, I'm scared of traffic, as usual. I live here in Chinatown, not too far from here. But other than that, I think it's good. I don't know if casino is actually necessarily good to make it, you know, to revamp it, but
I don't think a casino is what's needed here. I think just more independent shops, some cool art galleries, maybe a ped mall for the pedestrians would be really nice. I don't think a casino, the people come to the casino, they spend the money there, they drop it, they leave. They don't leave the doors of the casino. I'd like to really see bring the neighborhood back. Parking is a huge issue here. I've never had such a difficult time getting into this show.
Really?
And I think the mayor should really concentrate on working with McCormick Place and making things easier for conventions. Let's get some of those conventions to come back because it's a great space.
But that's his reasoning for a casino's pushing a renovation.
Yeah.
But not necessarily the casino, but
or the DePaul. I know DePaul was thinking of doing
a basketball arena here.
We need more parking as Miss Laurie had to park at her home in Chinatown and walk here today. We'd like to see some more parking. I wouldn't mind a little pedway as we go through here and maybe a few segues that we can drive through. And there's a lot of walking going on.
This is beautiful over here. I mean, you have the lake at part of McCormick Place. You overlook the lake. So let's get some mom-pop stores, some art galleries here, make it a place, an event space where you can have concerts outside.
And the reality, it needs to sustain all year long. This is still a residential environment. So if we're only playing to the moments, as in having conventions come in, we're forgetting about the in-between days. And there's a community here who can support those mom and
It's also good to mention, because of the parking, it's been really hardest. You know, we went to all the shows. Yeah. This time it's so much harder. It is 60,000 attendees that came on to this show. And 100 countries are represented on this show as well. So it's amazing. It's the big, it's so big that, you know, I don't know how I did it for 4 days, but I still have my leg attached.
You logged a lot of miles.
Yes.
All
yeah, you would
you.
Think I'd lose the weight from it, but no, not happening.
Now, I wonder how a casino would play so close to Chinatown, too. I mean, it'd be a straight shot to McCormick Place from Chinatown.
I'm going to make a pedway to Chinatown and introduce you to my
That would be great. Let's do that. Let's do a pedway to Chinatown.
Speaking about the restaurant show, and I know I'm going a little Chicago off topic, but so Tumblr was bought by Yahoo yesterday for I don't know how much.
$1 billion.
So here it says 1.8 billion restaurant industry sales on a typical day. The restaurants make 1.8 billion a day. So
that's a lot of money.
It kind of puts it in perspective for Mr. Tumblr, rich smarty pants now.
Well, Yahoo needs that cool factor, I think.
Yes.
And
yes.
I think it's very smart. I think Tumblr should be a little concerned.
Well, there's a new CEO at Yahoo, and this is like a big move.
It's a huge move. I wonder how Tumblr
should be concerned.
Yeah, Tumblr should be concerned.
Are you guys tumbling, by the way? Are you tumbling?
I'm a fan of Tumblrs. I am not personally tumbling, but I'm watching others and engaging through them. And but what I think is that it's going to lose some of its raw edge that has made it so accessible to young people and the artistic side of it. I'm concerned about Yahoo trying to kind of shave off those edges.
No, Yahoo's promised not to screw it up.
Okay.
I mean, direct quotes, like promise not to screw it up.
Is that in writing?
Yeah, that was a joke.
That's how CEOs talk these days, because they're that younger generation.
I know, but we'll talk more about Yahoo and Tumblr in our tech segment. But getting back to Chicago, a big change would be a casino. And the mayor has pretty much said, you know, the casino bill is working its way through the legislature in Illinois right now. And in that bill, which, you know, a lot of politicians say will pass, is the Chicago casino. It's more than likely that Chicago's getting a casino.
Boy.
Do you feel that that's going to change Chicago as a city?
I think that of all the things that we need right now, I'm not feeling casino.
Even though 100% of proceeds would go to education, supposedly.
Well, the reality is, you have to put the money into the casino for there to be proceeds to come out of it. And I'm concerned about that little cycle that's going on. We've got such an issue with poverty. We've got such an issue with unemployment. We've got such an issue
with families struggling. Which the casino would help, maybe, with some of the unemployment.
Yeah, be thousands of jobs. And construction jobs, thousands more ahead of that before a casino opens. But
I'm concerned about, you know, the devil we'd be
paying. Well, I know you also did that news report about the old post office.
The old post office
is another casino destination. Yeah.
And that site has been empty since 1991.
Oh, my goodness.
It is prime real estate. It's almost 3 million square feet. Yeah. A casino would fit in there with room to spare. Mm-hmm. There's talk of a high rise for condos and hotels and a whole riverfront with restaurants and shops and things that would really change that area, the South Loop as well.
That would be very nice to see that corner.
I could see it more
like
over there. All right, well, what else is in Chicago?
We mentioned education.
Poverty, education.
The big thing going on with Chicago parents is the closing of over 50 schools.
The proposed closing.
We're not going down yet. Yeah. The board is going to vote on this next week.
Yes.
And 52 schools are on the chopping block. Parents are working so hard to save a number of schools.
They're giving up their freedom. They were arrested yesterday.
Yes.
We had
a
three-day march that was organized by the Chicago Teachers Union. And yesterday, a number of parents and teachers and activists were arrested in trying to fight against this closing of almost 54 schools that they're looking at.
I wonder if they could build classrooms in the old post office on top of the casino.
See, we got it all figured out.
If they did that, they would probably put 50 students in each of those classrooms, which is kind of part of the problem right now.
I think we need to call Rom. Beth, you need to be in that.
Rom, you and I, we have so much to talk about.
And Rom owes you lunch, doesn't he?
He does.
That's right.
From like 1990.
Well, maybe he could buy it for you from a food truck at the Chicago Taste of Chicago that's happening. He's going to have food trucks at the Taste of Chicago. You might be able to get him to do that.
If any food trucks show up, right?
Well, they have 16 that put in applications. The deadline was this past week, and they have 16 that are in application. And so they're being reviewed, and we'll see how many get to go. But the lucky ones will pay a 10.25 sales tax.
Okay. Wow.
And on top of that, they will pay 25% of their gross profit.
Funny how the cycle works.
pop-up restaurants pay 20%.
Yeah.
The food trucks are going to pay 25%.
Maybe they'll take those trucks to Sweden or something. I don't know.
Well, you know, let's get back to the restaurant show and talk a bit about what were you most taken with just working this show, which is massive for the industry. I mean, this is the show.
Well, it's summer here in Chicago, and the great part that I found is Kendall College is in-house, so they're showing. I don't know if you've ever had a chance to dine at Kendall College.
I haven't dined there, but I know
I can't wait to.
I was just there about 2 weeks. Two weeks ago, and Chef Beverly Kim, who is a graduate from there, and she's also from Iron Chef, was cooking, and you know, with a culinary student. So there's a lot of stuff happening at Kendall College. If you're looking for really affordable dinner, they have like a whole series of Monday dinners,
like gourmet dinners,
and I think right now they have a theme of like Latin American cuisine. So they have, you know, go to their website, kendall.edu. They have a lot of great dinner series for.
I saw a lot of the students here too, which was very exciting.
Yes. So it's really nice to see them walking around.
I don't know. Well, Beth, what were you most taken with here at the show?
Well, there's going to be a lot, so you're going to stay tuned, and don't forget to tweet with us, Chicagonista Live #. NRA show, because we have so much to give away today.
12 certificates, right? 12?
12
today. 12.
Actually, more than 12.
More than 12.
More than 13, I think, actually.
Throwing food at you.
#, I can pick all of them.
Okay.
Some great restaurants. I mean, my favorite is Firehouse. Chicago Firehouse.
Yeah.
And
like
they're around the area here.
Yeah, that's
really great restaurant.
That's a great mainstay.
Right.
Speaking of Firehouse, it makes me think of fire cakes,
which makes me think of a donut girl.
Do we have, can we show that video?
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
We went
I'm
all
still
around.
Out of sugar.
Take a look.
No, it's just that I can't figure out where we should start. I know, Chicago's such a donut town. Let's think about one of the places. Well,
let's go get Nancy.
All right, let's go.
50 West Randolph at Do Right Donut. This is a hot spot because we separate ourselves from everybody else with our gluten-free donuts, with our vegan donuts, with our old fashions. We're committed to small batch donuts. We never fry more than 24 donuts at a time, and we're bringing fresh donuts up every 15 minutes, which really separates us from everybody else in the business, we feel.
Well, here we are at Do Right, and obviously these are our donut leftovers, but we're so lucky, girls. We have booked an incredible major celebrity donut guest, none other than the Big Donut.
Glazed and infused donuts on Fulton Market Street in Halston, West Loop. Our donuts are trans fat free, so that's good for your health. Our donuts are gigantic. They're about as big as somebody's face. We have a whole different variety of flavors that you'd never have before, and the quality is great. The craziest flavor that guests think we have is maple bacon. I think the craziest flavor is the blackberry goat cheese. That's really different. I've never heard of anything like that. I know I've heard of maple bacon and breakfast staples, but blackberry goat cheese, that's something really new and it's absolutely my favorite.
Couple, we do little fire cakes, and our fire cakes are little 2 or 3 bite donuts. Our other donuts are quite large in size. And our fire cakes have a tendency of being more explosive in flavors. And so the 3 fire cakes that we have right now, and they rotate and change constantly, is a bacon, maple, and pineapple glazed donut. Sensational. It's a huge pop and burst of flavor. The other 2 fire cakes is a chocolate espresso, and we make a really delicate espresso cream, the Roma chocolate on top, and then we crush roasted espresso beans on top. And then lastly is our peanut butter cup, which is a peanut butter mousse, salt roasted candied peanuts on top of a chocolate glaze.
Well, girls, you think we're set?
I think we have way more than enough.
Nah, I think we have enough for about an hour or so.
Let's go walk this off, girls, so we can start again. Let's go.
All right.
Why do donuts love to go to the dentist?
I don't know. Why do they?
Because they can't wait to see what the fillings are going to be.
Oh, my. Such a good
joke. Are you laughing? It was a good joke. Now, Beth worked really hard on that joke. Really, really hard. So please give her some feedback by tweeting Chicagonista Live NRA show. She needs to hear from you. But in general, I mean, aside from your joke, donuts are so smile-inspiring, and you know how much I love smiles.
Yes.
And so I am dying to know, since I wasn't on the donut crawl, which were your favorites?
You know what? I love hearing the owners of the donut places. They were talking about how really donuts are like very American. Hot dog, pizza, and it's making a big comeback. And I really didn't think about that whole thing about donuts. So,
And I love how they explain donuts as such a comfort food. And it goes beyond the cupcake trend. Mm-hmm. Because you can be so, you're creative with cupcakes. Yeah. But you can be really creative with donuts because they can be very savory.
Oh.
They almost turn into an Asian bun. Right?
Tweet Asian bun to Nancy Liu.
Asian buns. Wow Bow may have an issue
right
with
now.
That. Our friends at Wow Bow would definitely have an issue with that. But I love fire cakes because the chef there, he discussed it with such passion. And the fire cakes are small.
Yes.
And they're really just a small taste of like bursting with flavors. And my favorite was that pineapple, bacon, maple glaze.
Oh my God.
It was just like a pop of flavor.
So good.
And it was just
It's exactly how I explained it. It was very explosive. And it's good to know it's the same owner as La Madia restaurant.
Yes.
So the way he talks about how passionate he is in making those donuts is because he's so passionate about cooking his food in La Madia.
Yeah, so I've never met a donut that
And I
love.
Have to mention Fire Cakes is giving 1 dozen for 4 people.
Oh, yeah.
So keep tweeting hashtag NRA show and hashtag Chicagonista Live.
People from here are running out.
Explosion. You want an explosion of flavor. And, go for it.
And hashtag, their Twitter handle is firecakesdonuts.
Really good.
They're fantastic.
Make some friends.
And Glazed and Infused.
Glazed and Infused is terrific as well.
And Do Right Donuts.
And Do Right Donuts.
And we didn't, a lot of people were questioning us about Donut Vault. And we did it on a Monday, so we couldn't get to the Donut Vault. I've been to the Donut Vault. Like I said, I've never met a donut I haven't loved. they're worth a look, too. But we could, next time, Donut Vault, tweet with us. We'll come out to your donut place.
You know what our next thing is? And
I
know it's being talked about. Here at the next hot crawl is tamales.
Tamales.
The tamale is like a hot food item right now. And people are getting so creative with tamales. So our next crawl... Tamale crawl.
Okay,
tamale
crawl. To be to that one. Please tweet and tell them to invite me to that one. I want to go on the tamale crawl.
That would be so fun. We got to do it for the summer. We're definitely going tamale crawl.
So speaking of crawling, do you want me to speak? No.
Yes.
Did I?
Go for it.
Crawl away, Beth.
I was going to talk about, so after the donut crawl, I decided to come here to the National Restaurant Association show and do a little crawling, floor crawling, and I found some interesting items I want to share with you.
Please, I'm intrigued.
Okay, you're intrigued.
Okay. I am.
Yay. Okay, I'm going to ask you, and if you want to tweet along with us, play at home, don't go too far, can you guess what this product is right here? Let me show you.
Is it peanut powder?
Shut up.
Is it really?
Nancy's not allowed to play anymore. She can't play.
I don't want to play with you.
Oh, now she's going to go home.
That's
just me.
I swear I'm guessing.
You know.
Where'd she go? Is it really?
Yes.
Start again.
Okay, take two.
Pretend you didn't see that.
It's very cool. Very good. That's why she's in the news business. She just has a nose for news.
But I've never seen it marketed like this.
Yes, it's peanut powder.
What do you
powder.
Do with peanut powder? Because I don't know.
Well, you can rehydrate it.
Okay.
So this is chocolate peanut powder, and you put a couple teaspoons of water in it, and it is phenomenal on crackers. It's really good, and it's
But why would you want the powder form over anything
because it takes all the fat out of it. It takes all the oils out of it. It's like a better peanut
very
for you
interesting.
When you take it.
What? How does that affect with people who have a peanut allergy generally to...
There's still peanut people who have peanut allergies still should not consume this product. But what I found out something interesting is there's a doctor who's doing studies on children who have peanut allergies and trying to reintroduce them to the peanut so they could build up their system. And he's giving them little grains at a time of the peanut powder because it's so micro and helping to rebuild their system. So I love this company.
Don't try that unless you're a doctor.
No.
I just want to tell you now.
To find out more information about this company, and I met the owner, and it was just fabulous. So,
that's an interesting product.
Yes.
All right, the next one, Nancy
won't
guess.
There'll be more information.
I can't guess.
She's
what
not
it
allowed
is.
To guess.
Pass this down.
Nancy did not know what this is, just so you know.
Okay.
Now with this product,
don't make us eat it. We're not going to.
Yes.
Eat it.
No. But
what is it?
You can take a little bite off, a little tiny bite, and let it just kind of melt around in your mouth, but proceed with caution. A little bite.
Are you serious?
Yes.
You want us to eat it?
Yes. Why would I kid? Now I just gotta find out what it is. Where did I put the thing?
Oh, that's very aromatic.
Oh! Tastes like a flower.
No, take a little bit.
How many flowers have you eaten?
It's spicy, but it's good for you. It's like little pop rocks in your mouth, and chefs are using this. You don't like it. Somebody get Nancy some water.
I like it.
It's a flavor enhancer, and it's by this...
What are
chefs
putting
it on? Okay, that makes sense to me, because I don't feel like I'm tasting it, but I feel like it's occupying my mouth.
Yeah, and the more it's in your mouth, and if you have a soda with it or something, it takes the flavors of whatever you're eating, and it just explodes them in your mouth.
Really?
It's really interesting.
It's exploding.
Okay, now my tongue is tingling.
I have to find that. But its microgreens are very big this year.
Okay.
And so this is a box of microgreens, and you're going to start seeing these all over in the...
In salads or just...
Yeah, these are micro beet greens.
Okay.
We've got the Willy Wonka Nature's Bouillon. This tastes like bouillon. Micro mustard Dijon.
Okay.
Alfalfa pea sprouts.
Oh, pea sprouts we have in Chinatown.
Radishes and arugula. Okay. And chefs are using this.
Oh, that's an interesting arugula.
You know, in for garnish and soups, everything, microgreens.
Can you eat this right now? We're returning.
I know. See,
no, we're not. See,
no, no, don't eat those.
I wash them.
Why? Get rid of the taste of that.
Here, here's some water. You have been serviced. There you go.
It's Colbert cress and microgreens, and they're very big here at the Shell. Okay, I know I'm running out of town.
I really like
okay.
this one.
Does anybody know what this is?
What is it?
I don't know.
Oh, that's ginger.
Well, you know.
She did it again.
Okay.
Oh, well,
did you see that? Did you all
everybody
see that?
Everybody knows ginger.
We're Asian. So.
She's
Asian,
supposed to give a moment.
She's always got to be first.
Give a moment for the audience to come into possession
in
of the knowledge
of
before
Lou.
You answer the question.
Nancy Lou,
just
what's
saying.
This? Does anybody in the audience know what
is
this is?
Is it a carrot ginger?
A dehydrated carrot?
It's turmeric.
Turmeric?
Yes.
Oh, turmeric.
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 Some say turmeric.
Dr. Oz loves this. It's very good for you. We usually see it in a powder form like this, but there's this great.
It's very expensive.
Which is Bruce Coast Ginger Ale, and you can find them all over the place. They're out of Brooklyn, and they use real
turmeric.
A lot of Indian cuisine have turmeric.
It's very, very good for you, very healthy. So I thought that was interesting. And the last thing, which is really good, is these real bean coffees. And I got them for you. MJ loves her iced coffees, and they come in all these different flavors. It's all natural and no harmful ingredients, and they're iced, and they come in diet, iced cappuccino, dark roast with coconut water. They come with different flavorings, so
very
those were some. Oh, one more thing. Oh my goodness.
There's more.
This is the coolest thing ever.
What is it? You found this on the floor?
I can't open it.
What is it? It says flies.
It's a fly be gone. No, but look at it. Everybody loves to eat, and at the restaurant show, we're showing good food. Okay, this is a fly trap, and all you do is add water to it, and you hang it 30 feet from any place where you're having a fly problem.
Oh, I smell it.
Ooh, okay, 20,000 flies it will catch.
But what's the smell?
It's nature's favorite food. Flies love what's in here. Once you mix this ingredient in it, it's their favorite food. It's gourmet for flies. Flies be gone. Anyways,
let's enhance the flavor for the flies.
Gosh.
Put it in there. There we go.
You know what? It kind of smells like a dumpster.
And the fly be gone.
How do you know that?
Okay, I moved it. It's gone.
Just saying.
Anyways, cool products. I'll have links to all of them on our website. I want to thank everybody for donating these products to us.
Great, great product. And, you know, I wanted to talk about food travelers. We got them.
Oh, yes.
We got them to join us, thankfully, Sue and Diana. And they took us around the world, and I mentioned that earlier. We have a great video for you guys, and when the video comes back, we have Sue and Diana with us.
This is Sue Riddell
and Diana Lascaris,
and we're with Food Travelist. We're here today at the National Restaurant Show reporting for Chicagonista Live.
We're going to take you around the world for some tasty treats.
Pisco is the national spirit drink, alcoholic drink, and here to the fair we bring some of them to try to introduce you here to the Chicago market.
Pisco is actually available here in Chicago. You can get it at Binnie's, and also it's going to go to Costco as well. So it's a great product, very interesting, similar to maybe a light rum or a white tequila, and it's got a nice smooth and simple flavor.
Iberico is a very unique kind of pig from Spain. That's the reason why it's known as Iberic from the Iberian Peninsula. And this pig is fed on acorns for the last few months of its life. Acorn is a fruit, it's seasonal. Mm-hmm. So the acorn season goes from September to February. That period of time, six months, the pig is able to double its size in a very exclusive acorn diet. And this is the result. Buttery meat that melts in the mouth, the aftertaste, you know, it's so long, it's so intense, it's an amazing app.
Yeah. Wegschals is in charge of importing all of the raw Iberico meats from Fermin for the United States. Okay. At this show particularly, we are proud to announce and present our new smoked Iberico de Biota pancetta, which is similar to bacon, I guess you could call it.
It's the best bacon you've ever had.
Yes, and we actually won the Fabby Award here at the National Restaurant Association show for best new product.
We're here with Claudia from Prop & Peller, and we're going to talk about how Claudia and her company has brought the authentic tasting Bavarian pretzel to the United States.
We have an authentic Bavarian pretzel. Prop & Peller started in Munich with a Chicago native visiting at Oktoberfest, and the key question of that night was, why don't we have pretzels like that in the U.S.?
Exactly.
And that's how Prop & Peller started.
So what's unique about a Bavarian pretzel as opposed to other soft pretzels?
I think it's similar, like the beer. What makes the difference in German beer is the purity and the natural ingredients, the quality of the ingredients, and the careful process of making it. We take 4 hours to finish one pretzel. Well, we have a very famous Chicago Brauhaus, and we have the latest is the Hofbrauhaus in Rosen.
The Hofbrauhaus, yes.
Wow.
Thank you so much.
Wow. Thank you for traveling the world for us.
I had the honor of traveling with them and actually tasting a lot of this stuff, so it's phenomenal. Thank you so much for doing that.
Our pleasure.
I wish you brought the alcohol drink with you.
I really wanted the bacon one, but yeah. So tell us about Food Travelist.
Food Travelist is a social network and media network for people who are interested in food and travel. There'll be a component where people can talk with each other, share recipes, set up a profile, and talk about the things they're interested in with one another. And there'll be a component where destination marketing organizations, people with products and services, travel, you know, tours that are related to culinary travel can introduce their products and services to the people who are on there as well.
Well, you guys were telling us you've been to a few restaurant shows now.
Yes.
I'm interested to hear the comparison of this show to previous years.
Yeah, this show was really busy. I mean, there was a lot of people, and there was a lot of folks from international presence, which is great, you know, especially for us, because we're looking for the latest things, not just here, you know, in Chicago, but everything that's coming from around the world.
Wait, do you think we influence them more, or they influence us more?
Oh boy.
It's a big,
you know, it's a big happy family. Yeah. You can see trends that are occurring other places in the world that we bring here, and vice versa. And of course, we're such a huge market that everybody, you know, from the small countries wants to make sure that we're aware of the things that they're doing over there. And that can sometimes start a trend here as well.
I think it's great with, you know, social networking. I mean, everything we do every day, we take pictures of those food. Mm-hmm. And people that love traveling, I mean, it's a perfect situation for you to join that network. Now, how could they do that?
They can, right now, we're up on Facebook, Twitter, Pinterest, all the social media we've started, and we'll be launching the network this summer. So if you're interested in learning more about it, you can sign up right at foodtravelist.com. There's a one-minute video where they can get a little bit of a flavor of what we'll be doing, and then when we launch and become live, then we'll send out notices and everyone will be able to join.
I found some stats that said 93% of adults said they enjoy going out to restaurants, and 43% of adults said restaurants are an essential part of their lifestyle.
Oh, yeah.
And I wonder how that compares in other countries too. That would be interesting to find
out. Well, when you look at food travel, and specifically the fact that when people travel, not everyone goes to a museum, not everyone goes to a concert, not everyone goes out to play golf.
That's a great point.
But almost everyone goes out to eat, and sometimes three meals a day. And so that's the one constant that people who are traveling, whether they're coming, you know, from another place here or we're going there, or even within your own neighborhood, you know, we all eat. So that's a food is a common ground for all of
now,
us.
Now, do you have to be a foodie to use Travelist?
No, not at all. Because, you know, like Diana mentioned, everyone has to eat, you know, when they travel. And so some people, when they go out to eat, whether at home or away, some people like the gourmet experience. And some people like the food trucks.
Right,
you know, some
right.
people like to go out and have a hot dog or a cheeseburger. You know, there's zillions of pictures of wonderful looking cheeseburgers from around the world, right? I happen to have quite a few of them.
We've had a few of our own food calls, and they're not gourmet, trust me.
Awesome.
Thank you so
great job.
Thank
you guys
did a
great job.
Love
you.
Thanks so much.
Thank you.
And good luck on the launch this summer.
Yeah.
Thank you so much.
At Food Travelist is where you can find them on Twitter. We thank them for putting that video together and taking us around the show. And there is so much of this show to see.
Oh, yes.
There was a great Asian area, speaking of Asian. Okay. Sorry, we didn't mean to make fun of you.
It's okay. But I am at the front of the class.
We really did.
I didn't see a kosher area, but I did see a really good Asian. Speaking of Asian, oh my God, Duong's pictures.
Oh, I know.
Yes.
Let's Duong. Talk. I know Jason's going to be showing a little bit, and Nancy mentioned that she hasn't been back in, what, 35 years.
It's all of Saigon, it'd be 38 years.
And thank goodness for social media. We are still keeping up with our friend Duong all the way in Vietnam. I actually talked to her on Facebook. Of course, you know, she's up at night, and I'm up at night anyway, so that kind of works out. But, I mean, the picture she's posting, I know Jason's showing that to you guys, but it's amazing. And, you know, the food, I find, did you see that with the tiger food that she was showing?
The tiger fish.
The tiger fish.
Yeah, and there's fish, and she showed a lot of dim sum, and it has a lot of Chinese influence in Vietnamese cuisine, but the shopping that she's doing is what's getting my attention. She went and had she got her hair cut and styled. She had a massage. She had mani-pedi. Guess how much it cost?
I don't want to know.
$5.
$7.
Not for all
$7.
Of that.
I know, she's been cheaper.
All of it.
She's been going back to that massage every single day.
Oh my gosh.
Oh my goodness. I can't believe time is going by so fast, and I want to keep just going forward. But hello to Ramon Wow.
Yeah, Ramon Wow is here.
I wanted to show you guys, we also have Tony Sneerly, who did a video with us. I know I'm jumping, you guys, but I wanted to make sure we want to get it in. She also was our eyes for the NRA show, and she went around and looked for clean but local food. So take a look. This is Tony Sneerly from Food
clean,
Just Saying.
Local. Woo.
Hi, I'm Tony Sneerly with foodjustsayin.com. I'm here with Chicagonista Live. My aim has been to be on the hunt for local, clean, Midwestern food companies that produce products that I would feed to my own children. When I say clean, I'm looking for non-GMO, non-artificial ingredients, and just general, plain old healthy. So come along with me and we'll check them out. This is a local bakery out of Forest Park. It is an all-natural, which makes it different from many other local bakeries.
Most of our ingredients, as many as we can locally, and non-GMO as much as we can, and all-natural because my daughter has Crohn's disease, and I was always very aware of that and wanted to give her natural and good ingredients that, as much as we could, that don't have sugar where we can, and no flour, no additives, no colors, no... We do have a regular line of baked goods, but we have a whole line of natural food bars that have only a few ingredients with nuts and fruits.
I came across Zoy 100% soybean oil. I'm here with Representative Beth Westemeyer to talk about the soybean oil made in, it's in Michigan.
We are the only soybean processing plant and oil refinery in Michigan. So we process beans 360 days a year. We also have a full line of non-GMO seed that we do sell to farmers that are contracted to bring those beans back to us. So it's available at Meijer and online at Amazon.com. This is a non-genetically modified oil that has half the saturated fat. Those beans have been naturally bred to have half the saturated fat content that a regular vegetable oil would have.
I'm here with Carlton Johnson from Joya All Natural Soda out of Minneapolis, Minnesota.
With an almost 14-year-old son at home, we're always searching for soda alternatives. So I was really happy to see a product like this. Could you tell us a little bit about the ingredients in the product?
So they're all natural, so that means we're using the real cane sugar, nothing artificial, no artificial sweeteners, no high fructose corn syrups, no artificial colorings or flavorings. It's all natural, no preservatives. And so that way it makes it, you know, so much easier for your body to break down, and then being less sweet, they're a third to two-thirds less sweet than a regular soda.
So here at the restaurant show, I have found three wonderful Midwestern clean food companies, an all-natural bakery, a non-GMO oil company, and an all-natural soda. Here in the Midwest, there's so many companies, we just have to look, and some of them are no further than our own backyards. This is Tony Sneerly from Food Just Saying, signing off for Chicagonista Live.
Talk about that here.
We're back. I'm so sorry. I was going so fast. I thought we were running out of time. But thank you so much, Tony, from Food Just Saying.
Yeah.
She did a phenomenal
Such
job.
A great
finding
job.
Local stuff. I mean, it's so hard to kind of go through with yeah. so many products out there. And I know there's a lot more. I know Beth and I went around yesterday and found a lot more brands that we wish we could feature. It's just like really so many.
Yeah.
But speaking of like healthy food, Karen, our friend Karen, where we did our show...
Yeah.
You local know, and
I mean,
healthy.
Local.
Karen's on Green
yeah.
or Karen's Raw.
Yeah.
She would be a great one here in Chicago. Duana loves Karen and Beth. I mean, you just visited her, what, like
yeah.
a few weeks ago.
She's awesome.
She?
And she has a lot of her own products, too. So support local.
Support local.
She's amazing. I mean, she's aging like a 20-year-old. She looks like she's
aging back.
Almost
yeah.
20
amazing.
Years ago, Karen
she's
and
amazing.
I used to take ballet together.
Really?
Along with her daughter and her son. And we were all in there, and I hadn't yet started having my baby, so it was about 20 years ago. And she amazed me then in what she was doing, and
yeah.
she does not look like she's changed at all. I, however,
a little bit, but
she is still just the same, just
but
such
she,
a presence,
yeah,
such
she,
a healthy glow about her.
Exactly.
Yeah.
That's health. It's
yeah.
health.
It exudes from the inside out. It's
yeah.
really quite amazing.
And
yeah.
it's been nice to see at the restaurant show, which probably, you know, I can ask the Food Travelist girls, the really looking at healthy options that are available to restaurants, certainly healthy options for kids. In front of the booth, they have little placards that say these are healthy options for your kids, for the schools, because that's who's
yeah.
here. A lot of the schools.
That is a big theme that you're doing with
gluten-free
the
gluten-free is huge. Organic is huge. Some of the trends, the microgreens that we were showing are pretty big.
Yeah.
But just to give you an idea of, you can't even imagine the size
yeah.
of this show. I mean, that's
it's
why it takes...
massive.
It takes a couple days to really see,
yeah,
but I really
yeah.
like the trends that are happening there. One other thing I wanted to bring up about the show, very interesting, is they do have a technology pavilion. And you would think, well, why technology? Mm-hmm. Well, when you think about the restaurant shows, they're picking everything from the carpeting to the music to the door handles on the bathroom. They know your psychology of everything you think when you walk into a
mm-hmm.
restaurant to how long you have to wait. And talking about apps, we're social media creatures here on the show. They have apps that let you really get to know your customer. We were talking
yes,
about this yesterday.
We were.
To what they are. Are they vegetarian? Are they vegan?
Yeah,
do they have
yeah,
food
yeah.
allergies? So when they come to your restaurant and they check in, you know exactly who they are,
mm-hmm.
when their birthday is.
Yeah.
It's all about customer service. It's all about building a relationship. If they come into your restaurant once a week, or once a month, they want you to come in twice a month. Once a week, they want you to feel like home.
It's that social contract. I mean, we're all, this is the social media generation. We're all participating in that. And so we're looking for value. We have so few
yes.
dollars. We want the value. To be able to go into an environment and everyone knows your name and they know your
right,
preferences.
Right,
they know.
Right.
So ostensibly, that's going to make you feel better and give you an enhanced customer experience. And that's going to make you want to frequent that space more often, which is a win-win, a value
right.
get.
Right.
For both the customer as well as the retailer.
Well, then let's talk about restaurant apps.
Because
yeah. When it comes to value, I rely on Yelp, and I also rely on Foursquare, because when you check into a restaurant, I rely on what other customers have said about that restaurant, but often there are Foursquare specials. You'll get a free dessert, you'll get a free appetizer,
mm-hmm.
and you
mm-hmm.
will only get it if you checked in on Foursquare.
Right, so what the restaurants are...
I love restaurants that do that.
Because Foursquare and those are only going so far now, so a lot of the restaurants are creating at affordable... Restaurants could have their own apps. So if somebody
right.
comes in and checks into your restaurant, they can earn reward points to a free meal the next time they
right.
come in, gift certificates to give away to
right.
their friends and family, a bottle of wine. So the restaurants are really being encouraged
yeah.
with these apps
mm-hmm.
to really reward
Does it work with you? Because it's working on me. I'm like a bullseye.
Yeah, I feel like there's a lot of apps out there, too, like Open Tables,
yeah.
of course, another
here.
Famous one.
Yeah.
They're here, and they have a lot of those coupons
yes, that's
or
a great, network.
Great deals. And so, you know, I find myself having at least three or four or five, you know,
mm-hmm.
apps. And I don't know about you guys, but are you like on one app only, or do you actually go through all of your apps to see a good deal?
All it goes three.
Yeah,
all
exactly. Three. I think that's, you know, I think we all try different kind of apps.
But I do want to be
virgin, so I really
I want to be rewarded for my loyalty. You know, just like what you just said, I want to be rewarded for my loyalty to your restaurant, to your establishment. And if you don't, then I get a little, I'm going to try somebody else who might appreciate my business a little bit more.
I most definitely pay attention to the restaurants that are participatory in social media, because if you aren't, then I don't feel like you have a finger on the pulse of what's going on.
Then I have to confess, I actually went out of my way to go to a restaurant that I saw everybody tweeting about, and our friend Steve with Foodie Chats, he goes to Union Sushi a lot, and I started following Union Sushi because of Foodie Chats, and their Instagrams of their food made me come in.
And they've been great. I went there recently with Natasha Nichols, Houseful of Nichols, and we just happened in there after an event, and we were tweeting about it, and Union Sushi has been great about conversing with us. I haven't been back yet. I haven't had any time, but they keep trying to bring me back.
And Instagrams make me want to come back.
They're reaching out. They knew that I was participatory when I was there, so they're seeking me out. They're actually courting me as a customer.
Yes. It feels kind of good to be recording on Vine. I know you guys Vine as well, but the Union is really big on Vine, and I watch it, and I'm like, okay, I really want sushi right now.
I know.
And then I look at Yolk, and I'm like, I really want waffles right now.
They make me want breakfast.
Right?
It's crazy.
And I mean, and I think there's Beach Burrito, which show really
and
great
And Billy
Vines.
Deck is awesome, too, with Sunda and Rocket, and his new place, Chihuahua. So, I mean, you keep seeing food in my Instagram feed. It's making me want to eat out.
You know what? I think that restaurants could, if they would put one or two tables aside for social media people when they came in, where there would be charge plugs and maybe a little bit different lighting. Mm-hmm. The first restaurant, Billy Deck, if you're listening, this is my idea. You heard it here on Chicagonista. Put a table
a
in
idea.
Where we can sit and the lighting's kind of good, and maybe you have a little plaque there with all of your little Instagram hashtags.
And have tastings where you can tweet about whatever we just tasted.
Yes, please don't make me struggle to find any kind of branding for you, because when I'm taking pictures of my food, and I'm looking, I'm pulling out menus, trying to find something so that I can give you that value, that I can take
you know
my picture
I noticed
and have
too
something
in restaurants.
There.
So you want it to be tweeted out, and you ask a waitress or waiter, it's like, what's your Twitter? I'm like, oh, I don't know. And you know what? Missed opportunity, because I'm like, oh, okay, well, then I guess I won't tag you guys, because it really is such a
missed opportunity. But it has been fun to walk around and see some of the vendors that program the music to what you're eating, the smells, the feel of the silverware, the way that the placemats are, and the menus. I mean, it is mind-boggling how much goes into opening a restaurant. So kudos to the restaurants who work so hard to keep us there. Now keep us there. Engage us.
Keep on tweeting, hashtag Chicagonista Live, hashtag NRA Show. We have so much restaurants, gift certificates to give you guys. Dinner for two, $100 value. We have like Park Grill, La Cantina.
I better tweet.
We have, oh my God, Lamadi.
Awesome.
Oh my God. The top restaurants in Chicago are on that list.
Don't forget the donuts.
Yes. Don't forget the donuts. Bomb and Bricks. I mean, there's just so many of those restaurants.
Wow.
And we thank you so much to those restaurants that are tweeting during the show as well. We really appreciate you guys and for doing this with us.
Yeah.
And we'll pick them after the show. We're going to let this breed a little bit because we have so much to give away, and I think we can just pick it. We could use
the more you tweet with the Chicagonista Live hashtag, the more likely we'll see it, and more likely you may win one of those great certificates.
Ooh,
definitely, we'll be announcing all the winners at the end of the show.
And another thing I wanted to bring up, that they're doing a good job with social media, was thank you.
Oh, yes.
We have to mention
to our little...
This was after my bedtime yesterday.
Unfortunately, I missed it. I heard this was fantastic.
It was a beautiful night.
It was social
and
lounge.
The White Sox won. They beat the Red Sox.
I saw the home run.
So Sox Social Lounge.
It was really beautiful.
Just launched yesterday.
Yeah.
And we had a great time. Beth.
Hashtag Sox Social.
Sox Social.
Why are they throwing things today?
And unfortunately, Nancy couldn't make it.
But
But we had some really great friends. There's Dan Pearson. Thank you so much for inviting us. But we're so excited. We even met Manny the Frenchie.
Yes, yeah. I got
and
kisses.
He was like the cutest little
Frenchman, Manny the Frenchie.
French bulldog that we met. Oh, Duana was there as well. And
Jared Payton was out. Yeah,
Jared Payton was out. Steve Green, Foodie Chats. We were doing some Foodie Chats from the South.
Steve Green, of course, Foodie Chats was there.
Was Jeff Linger there?
Yes, Jay Willie.
The whole Chicago social media scene was there.
It was so fun. I mean, it's a great place where you can plug in your phone. So as long as you have a ticket, you can go to the Sox Social Lounge.
Really?
Yes, that's a key point. They have charging stations on the wall, and soon they're going to have a seating arrangement that will have charging stations at the table. But it is so helpful because even MJ, in the middle of our nachos in the hat,
helmet. Oh my God!
Well, she had to do some charging, and we were able to do that right there. So it was really beautiful to kind of just step away, and you were just steps away from the game. So every time I heard something went running out, and I caught it, and I got to be able
and
to be
participating. And people watching the Hawks game on one screen, multi-sports testing.
And the exciting part is we might be going and broadcasting the next show.
We're really excited about that. Not that we're trying to butter them up, but you know.
I know, because they're watching at White Sox. Thank you so much.
U.S. Cellular Field.
We love
maybe
you guys.
Yes, at White Sox, hashtag Sox Social.
That's fantastic. I love how Major League Baseball, and I mean a lot of major sports teams, I mean all professional leagues, have taken such a push with social media. Mm-hmm. And I think players know that, you know, they now are expected to tweet and not cross any lines. But I mean, it's kind of the same with news media. I mean, journalists are expected to tweet and kind of share the stories that we're covering and not cross a line. People have lost their jobs.
So yeah, well, that's true. The difficult thing when you go to a baseball game is the selection of food.
Oh, yeah.
What to eat. But actually, I never have a selection problem with food wherever I go. But perhaps you're somebody that has a restricted diet. I was very impressed to see they had garden burgers. Mm-hmm. They had healthy choices. Yeah. You could walk to the other side and get a turkey sandwich. The tacos that you got might have been healthy if they weren't in like a big baseball helmet.
You have no idea how large that nachos were.
It was for sharing.
No. I got a text message from MJ as I was out in the game saying, come back quick, I need you. I thought something was wrong. I went running back. She's like, I can't eat all of this.
That's true, actually, because I ordered the helmet. Duana made me order it. And it came to me. It was like an actual big size helmet. I'm like, what do I do with this? She ordered her own. I ordered my own. I can't finish it, so I had to text her an emergency.
Yes. So nine innings.
I thought it was one of those little helmets.
I thought it was those little,
like a little
baby helmet.
I'm a pinch eater. That's what I am.
It's a party.
Pinch eater. That's what I am.
I'm walking in with a big helmet, and they're all looking at me like, you're going to eat all that?
And Duana took the helmets. She's going to make planters out of them. They're big enough for an entire garden, actually.
There you go. Helmets. That's how big it is.
That's how big of a White Sox fan she is.
Duana's a vegetarian, and once again, to Copper Crest, these are grown. We could give you these to put in the helmet.
There you go.
To grow.
Perfect.
What a great idea.
Oh, a marriage made in heaven.
That's a great
White Sox
idea.
And Copper Crest.
Kind of like nachos.
From nachos to healthy food.
But sort of.
It was a blast.
Oh, my God.
It was a blast, and Manny the Frenchie dog who was there, he was taking this, he's supposedly really popular on
Instagram,
and he has like
Manny underscore
no,
the
boo
underscore
is
Frenchie.
It with the
but
dog
I don't think
world.
He's Boo is specifically on Instagram, is he?
He's on Facebook.
So this one is Instagram.
Instagram and Twitter.
190,000 followers.
And
I
have to tell you, that was a very well-behaved dog. I really wanted to bring him along and have
really,
him
really
my children.
Cute.
He was really wonderful.
And we're going to see if we can get him as a guest if we happen to do a show.
Because he could probably literally sit in here.
He would.
And he just like
ears
looks
just
at you like this.
Straight up.
Someone was putting a beer bottle beside him.
Who was that? Who was that?
Not me. But I did vine it.
Beer bottle.
I didn't do it. I vined it though. So if you want to look at my
I didn't do it. I just videotaped it.
He was really, really cute. So
all the things
we don't see it on social media. It didn't happen.
Right.
But it was fun. And we miss you, Nancy. We wish you were there.
I know. Well, I do want to make it to the social media lounge someday.
Well, and they're doing a lot of family, a family initiative there, and they've reduced some prices for certain family games.
Well, it's always been family
friendly. And so there, we've got to go there during the weekend on a daytime game.
Okay.
Nice family game.
Yeah,
you can bring the kids.
Yeah, the 1 o'clock start. I'm there.
Yes.
Okay.
There
we
go.
I want to thank Jean, who's out there tweeting away, letting you know the more that you tweet with the hashtag Chicagonista Live and hashtag NRA Show, the better chances to win some yummy dinners here in Chicago.
A lot better than buying that Powerball
ticket. We also have a lot of bloggers outside Chicago who's watching today, and I'm really excited because they're coming in town for this big conference called Blogger. 5,000 women or bloggers are coming in town, and this is perfect opportunity for them to win those gift certificates and actually, you know, I mean, it's expensive to come in the city and eat away, and here you go. You have an opportunity.
And you do want to eat your way through the city. It's really important. We really value
this.
That.
This is such a foodie town.
It
is. And so many chefs here that have come spoken at the National Restaurant Association show. The only downside to the National Restaurant Association show is the name. When you tell people you're going to the NRA show, they're like, what? And then you start this whole firestorm. Oops, sorry, I spit on you, but I get
what?
You know,
it's
right?
True.
So you have to
restaurants.
Say,
they need to brand for themselves. Then we need to have a little conversation about branding. So yeah, they need to own their own letters.
If you do restaurant show, it is long. You can't say rest show because then that doesn't make sense.
A bunch of lazy people are going to McCormick Place to learn how to rest.
So I really understand why it's NRA show, but at the same time, it's gotten to a point. You know, for the longest time, every time I tweet, I put National Restaurant Show.
Yeah.
But then it got to a point, okay, NRA show. I think
well,
they
if it's
get it
National Restaurant Show, it'd be NRS.
I don't know. I saw some guys in fatigue show up, and they looked confused. I think they thought that this was the NRA show. So they happily got some waffles and were on their way.
The NRA show is wrapping up. And, I mean, we're thrilled that they allowed us to do a Chicagonista Live show.
Thank you,
from
NRA.
Here.
Thank you so much.
And to McCormick Place and whether it grows or not, I mean, this is a staple of Chicago.
Oh, yes.
It's very, very.
It's great. But there's a reason the restaurant show is here is because Chicago,
food.
As you mentioned, I mean, we're a foodie town.
We can't wait to
so maybe
come back next year.
At the post office, they should put a restaurant, school in the basement, and then a casino, because then the food could come up to the casino, and then what the casino doesn't consume, it can go up to the school kids, and... Okay.
No.
She's up here.
No.
You can quit now. Rob's not coming back.
I am the only one at this table with children in the Chicago public school system, so no.
Are there schools going to be affected? I hope not.
Well, we're I mean, all there affected. Is great concern. I mean,
there should be.
Kids
there's great concern.
Crossing serious gang territory.
We need to look at it.
It's a safety issue.
It's a safety issue. It's about what we consider to be tolerable for our children to have in terms of the environment, in terms within the school. My children have upwards of 32 and 35 students in their classroom. That's also what this is about. So we all need to look at it. Even if our children aren't in those schools, we need to, as a city, collectively take a look at this and be concerned because it affects all of us.
On the other side, though, there are some of the schools that are closing are at such low capacity. I mean, below 50%.
Well, but then the low capacity we have to look at. When we say half full, if your classroom's at 20, there are private schools, Chicago Lab, Latin, they don't have more than 20 in the classroom. So it comes down to semantics. What do we consider to
be difficult? So it will be solved today, but I'm going to tell you what will be solved today because I take the show over. I do want to thank Real Beans. I want to thank these guys why am I blanking on their name? Because it was Fabulous Ale, the Peanut Butter Guys, the Corporate Crisp. But speaking of beautiful children in Chicago, I just have to brag on 1 second. Chicago Parent Magazine, pick it up right now. The most beautiful little girl in Chicago, Arcady, is on the cover.
Yes, she's a cover girl.
Of the Summer Magazine.
That's
and it
so
went,
cool.
They sent me the picture yesterday, which I'm sharing with you today, and they're watching, actually. So it's a... summer going places issue that they're having.
Fantastic.
We had such a great time doing that photo shoot. So
at Chicago
and that space
at
looks Chicago so Perry. Fantastic. The water park that she was at.
It's an indoor water park in the south side that just opened, and they closed it down for the shoot, and it was like so fun. And she
Fantastic.
Loved it, and we're excited to get that magazine. So thank you, Chicago
Yay,
Perry.
Happy
and
summer.
A shout out to my beautiful daughter who graduated
from Congratulations.
Honors who is tweeting with us today.
We're proud parents as well.
Lots
social
of proud parents.
Miss Laurie's birthday was yesterday.
My birthday was.
It was yesterday.
It was last week Tuesday.
Happy
yes, thank you very much. Yes, I'm nice and 43,
quick,
and there
quick,
we go.
Quick thank you to Blast Marketing PR for getting all those restaurants on board. All those restaurants were so great in giving us all those giveaway. Hashtag Chicagonista Live, hashtag NRA Show. Duong is working really hard in getting all the winners, and we will tweet you guys those winners and let you know.
Keep tweeting. We hope you win, and we will see you next month.
Keep tweeting, keep eating.
Chicagonista Live. Thanks for being with us.
Yay.
Thank you,
companies. I'll link to all of you. I love you. Just can't remember your names.
Yay.